you. Good morning, everyone. I'm happy to be here in presence with you. So it's a very, very nice thing, finally. So in this today, we know that HIV is now is a manageable infection due to the fact we have a lot of drugs that works very well. They are very potent and with high genetic barrier, but also because we diagnose very well the patients since that they enter in care. So thanks to this effort from for the side of the drugs and for the diagnostics, we have very good results now. And the resistance testing is crucial and remain crucial because, as we know, HIV is a virus that is able to develop very fastly resistance if we have a particular event, suboptimal and incomplete suppression. The incomplete suppression after the starting of the treatment can be related with a suboptimal regimen. We have not so much problem about that because the drugs are very, very strong now, but we can have also problem with adherence, so the compliance of the patients, the bioavailability of the drugs, and also the extent of the reservoir of the viruses that can be present in individuals. And if the incomplete suppression occurs, HIV is able to mutate and to insert mutation, able to create new variants, able to survive in the presence of the drugs. These variants can point. These variants can be created during the incomplete suppression, or also they can be present before and after selected. And now we have a lot of technologies that can help us to detect resistance mutation also as a minority variant. So we can detect resistance very, 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 very soon. And in this talk, I will give you some consideration about that because I think that this is very, 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 very important. And we will focus the attention on several fields of the drug resistance. We will talk, share some consideration about transmitted drug resistance with the acquired resistance at first line therapy, and what about and something about the impact of the pre-existent resistance in virologically suppressed individuals that need switch, and also some consideration about the characterization of the multi-drug resistance individuals. Starting from transmitted drug resistance, we have recent good news because these are the data from the EURESIST database in which they surveyed the rate of transmitted drug resistance in Europe, and authors found that in general transmitted drug resistance is decreasing over time since 1995 to 2019, especially concerning the PI resistance and NRTI resistance. The NRTIs are quite stable, and it is expected because the mutations that are related to NRTIs resistance are not associated with a high cost on viral fitness, so they can spread more easily among CRT-naive individuals. But this is the tip of the iceberg because this paper is based on Sanger sequencing. So the surveillance made by Sanger sequencing can provide us information on the majority quasi-species with more than 20% of prevalence in intrapatient quasi-species. But with next generation sequencing, we can do more and we can have a more clear picture of the complete variability of the quasi-species. At this regard, we have a new study, a recent study in which was analyzed the transmitted drug resistance using the next generation sequencing. And the authors observed that there are a lot of mutations that are detected only by NGS due to the fact they are present in minority quasi-species. This gray scale represents the minority quasi-species, and they are spread to all the class. But they saw an important thing, that the NCI resistance is still low, and only the mutations that we found are related to minority quasi-species that of whom we don't know the clinical relevance. And these data are confirmed by another. Oh, sorry. Turning yet? Okay. These data are confirmed by English study that that performed the same analysis, so with next generation sequencing. And again, resistance to integrase inhibitors is quite zero as majority quasi species. They saw some minority species, and these species had a marginal mutational load, because with next generation sequencing, we can calculate also these parameters that correspond with the resistant burden present in the patients, and for NCI is quite low. They saw something about NNRTIs, and we already know that the presence of minority quasi species to NNRTIs can give some problem to the response to the NNRTI based first line treatment. But the data are still heterogenic, and by the fact that probably NNRTI, an integrase inhibitor, will take over the NNRTI at first line, we need more study to understand which is the correct cutoff to consider for NGS, because the WHO in this review admit that until now is challenging evaluate the clinical impact of minority quasi species. So we need to decide which is the correct cutoff, and also we need to study more and to use more this technology, because they are affordable now, so we can accumulate more data and we can have something more to study, because at the moment with the drugs that are recommended, so the second generation integrase inhibitor based regimen, we have not so much problem related to the transmitted drug resistance. But what happened at first line failure? This is another important thing, because at the beginning of the therapy, it's important that the patients are maintained with a good durability without accumulating resistance. And thanks to this, now we have patients that do not accumulate so much resistance over time. What is the situation? I like so much this slide that is old, because it's the first slide in which we found this zero. We never found a resistance under dolutegravir failure at first line. So dolutegravir and darunavir showed an excellent genetic barrier at first line. I tried to update this slide with data about bictegravir, and I put also the data, about the dolutegravir 3TC that we can include also as first line regimen, and the doravirine. And again, the genetic barrier of the second generation inhibitors is very, very good. And we have just one case in the clinical trial of resistance to dolutegravir 3TC, both in integrase and reverse transcriptase, but it's just one case of a non-adherent patient. So this combination can provide us a good, they can assure us no accumulation of resistance after failure. And also doravirine work better than the first generation inhibitor, the first generation NNRTIs, even though it's not at the same level of the second generation inhibitors. So the concern about the resistance at first line treatment are not so much. And the rate of the incidence of resistance at first line is low. We have some failures, but only few patients had failure with acquired resistance. This is a work from Stanford University in which they observed the response after first line treatment. And despite the improvement of the treatment, the resistance is still present, because we should remember that the resistance is not only related to the drugs, it can be caused by other factors. Indeed, the risk factor associated to the acquisition of new resistance are the low CD4 cell count at baseline and the high viremia at baseline. So patients that start treatment in a compromised condition, the late presenter, those with very compromised immune virological condition, can have a high risk to acquire resistance. And again, the drugs are important. Dolutegravir and darunavir and ratutegravir works better than the NNRTIs. And we confirmed this data in this our large study in which we evaluated the first-line treatment based on integrase inhibitors on around 800 Italian patients. And in this table, you can see the few individuals that developed at least one resistance mutation in reverse transcriptase or in integrase. As you can see, all of them were treated with first-generation inhibitors, and the majority of them showed viremia more than 500,000 copies and or CD4 count less than 200 copies. So this work confirms again this tendency. So I will share with you some consideration about an important group of individuals, those that need the treatment switch when they are virologically suppressed. We know that switch strategy for virologically suppressed individuals are now something that is very common in clinics. A lot of patients need to switch treatment to avoid the long-term toxicity of the heart, that is long life, to improve the quality of life, to decrease the pill burden. But the guidelines give us some recommendation about the fact that it's crucial to revise the history of these patients, the history of the treatment, of the toxicity concern, of the historical resistance. And sometimes it is not possible to do that because the information sometimes are not complete. And we can use new tool also to evaluate the resistance, such as the DNA sequencing, so the sequencing of HIV DNA. And because we know that resistance is a problem for those switch strategy that contain anchor drug with low intermediate barrier. We already saw that with raltegravir, we saw that with rilpivirin. So for these drugs, it's important a very good assessment of the previous resistance history. And now we have another example. Cabotegravir, rilpivirin, the long active, can be affected by the presence of baseline RAMS, baseline resistance mutation to rilpivirin. So also in this case, it's crucial to do the genotypic resistance test. Even though alone the resistance is not a problem, we have to add at least two risk factors related to the long acting, because the subtype A6A1 and the high body mass index. But this is a signal that the cabotegravir rilpivirin is a treatment based on drugs that had not so high genetic barrier. So we should assess very well the patients before the switching. And now there are a lot of studies that are assessing the percentage of individuals that can be eligible to this new strategy. And HIV genotyping can help us so much because it is affordable. We can do that in suppressed individuals. And there are several studies that are studying the usefulness of this technique that is still debated because there are some concern about the fact that the HIV DNA can provide us an underestimation of resistance. This is probably due to the fact that, especially in case of patients with a long history of virological suppression, there is a dilution of the mutation in the quasi-species. And maybe this is the reason why we found this underestimation. But we should underline that this underestimation is mainly related when we use the Sanger, when we use the next generation sequencing, situation change. And we saw that the information retrieved from DNA genotyping, Sanger genotyping, is useful because when we switch patients and we have the information of the DNA at baseline, patients with a resistant regimen in the DNA had an higher risk to have virological rebound after switch. And this risk is increased if they had also resistance in the RNA. So to have both the compartment with resistance is associated with the high risk to fail treatment switch. And these are data on Sanger, but when we talk about NGS, this gap, this underestimation is a bit lower, and the sensitivity of the DNA to detect the mutation present in the plasma historical genotype is very, very good. So it's important to improve to implement this technology, especially for those individuals that need a switch, because we can have more information. And the DNA genotyping is not only for patients that had a non-complete resistant history. Because the information retrieved from the DNA can implement the picture of the resistance history of the patient. We can have some concern about the fact that in DNA we can find a mutation related to the ApoBec editing, an enzyme that, as you know, introduces G2A mutation in the proviruses that sometimes can cause the generation of mutation or resistance mutation that are not really related to drug pressure. So that, especially with the next generation sequencing, we had this type of information. And we tried to use it. We tried to not eliminate completely this signal. And we found that, for example, patients that for whom it was done the NGS in DNA at the baseline of the treatment switch, we found that stop codons were frequently detected in patients who maintained virological control, while not in patients that had BLIP. As you can see by this green bubble, represent the stop present in the patients that responded to therapy, and the red symbols represent the patients that do not respond, so they had very, very few stop and very few species at lower frequency. So we can use also this additional information from the DNA. And this is necessary to do that because we have, I think, the needing to have a complete picture about the quasi-species. And even though the resistance seems to be not a big problem when we switch our patient with second generation integrase inhibitors. The triple therapy containing bictegravir and lutegravir work very well despite the presence of previous resistance. This paper talks about the presence of 184V. The efficacy of BFTAF was very high, also in patients with archived resistance to NRTIs. And we have some data similar to that. We performed a similar analysis in our observational cohort, and again, we found that the pre-existent resistance do not affect the outcome in virologically suppressed individual that start BFTAF. As you can see in this slide, the rate of the failure that is very low, we can count the events with our hand, is equal in both patients with fully susceptible or partially susceptible drugs. This is another paper that demonstrates that the 184V do not affect the response to the lutegravir TTC. And this is an important thing because there are a lot of debating about this mutation. And there are several studies that demonstrated that this mutation do not impair the switch treatment. In particular, the lutegravir TTC, that being a dual therapy, could be more fragile in this context. And about that, we have a lot of criticism because there are some observational studies that seen that there is a combination effect of the presence of 184V with a short time of viral previous suppression. There there are discordant data, there are different cutoff of the time, but we found the same thing. This work is our work that was submitted to CROI 2 years ago, and now it's submitted to GIGAR, the update. We found that per se the 184V is not relevant in the efficacy of dolutegravir 3TC, but patients that had 184V with the context of previous virological suppression less than 3.5 years had a higher risk to have a virological rebound. So this is another point, this is another question mark, but what we should do? I think that there is a lot of data about this argument, and maybe it's necessary to confirm this observation with ad hoc clinical trials, because the different cohort can provide different data, and we need to assess very well this concern about 184B. And at the end of the my last concept are related to the multi-drug resistance. That is another problem. Consider that patients with multi-drug resistance are now, I think, the patients at higher risk of death among the HIV-infected individuals, because they sometimes have no treatment option and the clinician don't know which salvage regimen built for these individuals. And the people that acquire the multi-drug resistance are those that, in brackets, grow up with the HIV. They are the survivors of the infection of the 80s that take all the possible regimen that we had, and also the perinatal infected individuals in the 90s that grow up with HIV. They accumulated so much resistance now that they have not any more option. They are not so much, because these are the data from the last data from our resist cohort. The resistance to three drug classes had an incident top in 2005 and after decreased, and the fourth class is quite low, less than 1%. Concerning the prevalence, we can consider in general that around the 10-12% of ART experience individual had at least three drug class resistance. So the phenomenon is not so wide, but we need to do something concerning that. And we need to find new drugs that can be new option for these patients with this so high frailty. And we have several drugs: the capsid inhibitors, the attachment inhibitors, the monoclonal antibodies. I will not, for problem of time, I will not give you some notice about the resistance on these drugs, because I want to focus also the fact that we need to better assess the resistance in multi-drug resistant individual. And we can do that doing the genotyping on the DNA. In this recent work, we evaluated 20 heavily treatment experienced individuals with four drug classes, and we performed the genotyping with NGS in RNA and DNA in viremic patients, and we compared the result with the historical mutation. As you can see, these patients are very complex. Each bubble represents a mutation, and the size of the bubble represents the viral burden of the mutation. And in this study, we found that DNA sequencing provide new information, because several mutations that are present in the historical genotype are detected by the DNA, sequencing. So this test can provide us more important information about the presence of the archived mutation, potentially relevant mutation in these very complex individuals. In conclusion, I would so we saw that transmitted drug resistance in Europe is low, but we need to assess better the usage of next generation sequencing, because we don't know still now, after years of the availability of this technique, which is the clinical relevant cutoff of the minority quasi species. Regarding the resistance acquired at first line, we have very good news again, but we should admit that there are some patients that remain fragile and the drugs cannot do everything. So we need to assess potential new strategies for these individuals that are very fragile. And regarding the treatment switch, we have no particular concern when we use drugs with high genetic barrier, but DNA genotyping can provide us important information, and also the evaluation of the APOBEC editing may give us some more information about to identify potential individuals at higher risk to have a virological rebound. And at the end, multi-drug resistance is still a problem, but we have new drugs that for them we will study the resistance, because we need to change also the assessment of the resistance, because we need to sequence new area of the HIV genome, and we have not so much enough data to do that. But the technology and next generation sequencing can provide us important information to assess better the salvage regimen in these individuals. And I'm finished, and thank you for all of you for the attention.